Could we evacuate Earth? Imagine that a great calamity is afflicting Earth. Maybe a neutron star is barreling toward us, threatening the survival of man and the planet itself, making life here impossible. What would mankind do? In order to survive, we'd have to leave our home planet behind. How can we evacuate Earth, and where can we go? Can we save everyone? How feasible is a complete exodus from Earth? There are 7.9 billion human beings currently living on this planet, and the types of rockets we use now can only lift crews of a handful of people into orbit. How could we create a massive spaceship able to sustain a large population for as long as a century that can travel at least 65 trillion kilometers? Are we capable of developing an engine strong enough to power a spaceship 25 kilometers long to a distance so great? We have no knowledge of any other planets that are supporting life, placing the ultimate gamble on an educated guess. Where in the universe do we send this ship? In this video, we're going to take a closer look into how possible it would be to evacuate Earth. Before we look at this, a quick reminder to give this video a thumbs up if you're enjoying it, and also to subscribe to Brain Impact for more videos just like this one. But now, back to evacuating Earth. Earth won't always be fit for occupation. We know that in 2 billion years or so, an expanding sun will boil away our oceans, leaving our home in the universe uninhabitable, unless, that is, we haven't already been wiped out by the Andromeda Galaxy, which is on a multi-billion year collision course with our Milky Way. Moreover, at least a third of the 1,000-mile-wide asteroids that hurtle across our orbital path will eventually crash into us, at a rate of about 1 every 300,000 years. Given the risks humans pose to the planet, we might someday leave Earth simply to conserve it. The amount we consume each year already far outstrips what our planet can sustain, and the World Wildlife Fund estimates that by 2030 we will be consuming 2 planets' worth of natural resources annually. The onslaught of droughts, earthquakes, epic rains, and floods over the past decade is triple the number from the 1980s and nearly 54 times that of 1901. Some scenarios have climate change leading to severe water shortages, the submersion of coastal areas, and widespread famine. Additionally, the world could end by way of deadly pathogens, nuclear war, or the misuse of increasingly powerful technologies. None of the threats we face are especially far-fetched. Climate change is already a major factor in human affairs, for instance, and our planet has undergone at least one previous mass extinction as a result of asteroid impact. According to Tim Hammer Tothfahill, a research engineer at the Advanced Information Systems Division of Defense Contractor General Dynamics, the dinosaurs died out because they were too stupid to build an adequate spacefaring civilization. So far, the difference between them and us is barely measurable. In 2005, the then NASA Administrator Michael Griffin described the aims of the National Space Program in similar terms. If we humans want to survive for hundreds of thousands or millions of years, we must ultimately populate other planets, he said. But how do we replicate life on Earth, establishing gravity, give us air to breathe and food to eat on a journey that could last several generations? As it stands, we would need something like 750 million rockets to carry away every person, to say nothing of equipment, supplies, or our other biological brethren. Manufacturing and launching that many rockets would take millions of years to accomplish. To send 143 pounds of anything into space also requires the same amount of fuel that the average American household consumes in 2 months. Now consider that the combined weight of the entire human race is about 400 million tons, meaning we would use up all Earth's fuel just getting everyone to safety, and that's when the critical power failure would kick in. Let's say it was possible for all humans to somehow make it off the planet with enough resources to build a new life. Where would be the best place to head to? Outer space itself isn't hospitable to life. We require liquid water to live, which can't exist without sufficient atmospheric pressure and temperature. Outer space is essentially a vacuum with no matter between planets and stars spread very thin. Liquid water isn't possible in that environment. But many places besides Earth exist where liquid water is actually possible. Places such as several of the moons of Jupiter and Saturn, as well as Mars and Venus, in the distant past. So we need to either find a place where water in a liquid state exists naturally, or we need to construct one. We also need the basic elements that make up our bodies and a source of energy. Luckily, both those things are reasonably common out there in the universe. Beyond the absolute basics, there are other considerations. Space is filled with dangerous radiation sources from both our sun and from beyond the solar system. Without proper shielding, this radiation can damage our cells, sterilizing life. Shielding can be made of thick barriers, hydrogen-rich materials, or magnetic fields. Earth naturally provides both with a thick atmosphere and a global magnetic field. Our bodies evolved into Earth's gravitational field. In outer space, far between massive bodies, gravity is relatively weak, which will harm us in a number of different ways. Our bones will lose mass, and major muscle groups will atrophy. And acid reflux will be a constant problem. We would need to have natural gravity or simulate it with acceleration, linear or centripetal. NASA's recent twins study revealed that astronaut Scott Kelly, who spent 344 days orbiting Earth on the International Space Station, underwent genetic mutations and experienced a decline in cognitive ability compared to his twin brother Mark, who remained on Earth. There are three classes of places that we could consider for our new home, the first being space stations. We would need to construct space stations that have self-sustaining closed ecological systems. This means that humans would need to live in symbiosis with other organisms aboard such a station, just as we do now on Earth. If these stations could be constructed in Earth's orbit, relatively close to the Sun, it could provide most of the energy we would need. A challenge to building these stations is that everything, every resource, will have to be brought into the station initially, and it would take a long time to construct the amount of stations we would need. The second option would be enclosed habitats on other worlds. If we could build a self-sustaining closed ecological system in space, then we could also do so on the surface of the moon or a planet. One advantage of this approach is the easier access to raw materials like water and minerals that might be either on the surface or accessible below the surface of a world. The moon is the closest option on which to build such a habitat. There's frozen water hidden in permanent shadows at the bottom of craters located at the poles of the moon. Then there's Mars as another option for surface-based habitats. Humans can live in habitats on Mars comfortably and indefinitely, but some have entertained the notion of attempting to transform the Martian environment into something more like it was billions of years ago, to match the conditions on Earth more closely. This process is called terraforming. Mars, however, is much farther away and would take months to reach, rather than days. This would limit the number of people who could be moved there. Mars has higher surface gravity than the Moon, making it a closer experience to that of Earth. The downsides are that the atmospheric pressure is low, with little free oxygen, and temperatures are quite cold. It might take many thousands of years to get Mars to reach something similar to Earth, but there would be hope for an Earth-like environment in our own solar system if we are willing to do the hard work. The third option is other Earth-like planets. This option would mean having to look beyond the solar system. Over the past couple decades, astronomers have discovered thousands of planets orbiting other stars near us in the Milky Way galaxy, which are called exoplanets. The detailed properties of these planets have not yet been determined, so nobody knows if they could sustain human life, but it is estimated that there could be some 40 billion worlds like Earth out there. The problem is their distance. The nearest potentially habitable exoplanet actually orbits Proxima Centauri, the nearest star to our Sun. This system is 4.25 light-years away, meaning it takes light 4.25 years to make the journey. But we can't currently build any spacecraft that could achieve speeds anywhere approaching light. The fastest spacecraft we've ever built moved at about 253,000 kilometers per hour. At that speed, it would take 18,170 years to reach Proxima Centauri. All of these suggested routes, however, may fall under the category of what Isaac Asimov called planetary chauvinism. We could just as well build an orbital habitat, erecting our future home in the void and engineering each of its details to our own exacting specifications. Financially, if not technologically, it is impossible to launch the amount of materials from Earth that one would need to build a large orbiting structure. But such a habitat could be constructed primarily of resources extracted from near-Earth asteroids, which in themselves provide more terrestrial variety and potential surface area than all the planets in our solar system put together. But with scientists and entrepreneurs alike looking into how to colonize Mars or the Moon, maybe we'll find a way to make life on one of those two rocks possible. If neither of those options is feasible, we'd probably end up living on giant versions of the International Space Station, but considering the astronomical costs, not to mention the technology and resources required to make it sustainable, that option's not feasible either. Truth be told, for any of this to be possible, we'd need at least 1,000 more years to perfect the technology. And who says humanity will even last that long? There are a lot of brilliant people on this planet, but can we truly outwit Mother Earth? Do you think you could manage to live on Mars or the Moon? Let us know in the comments box, and please like this video if you've enjoyed it. If you want to see more videos like this one, then subscribe to Brain Impact for more. Thanks for watching.